Greetings, mortals.
Wow, going through this old file footage feels weird. My voice sounds strange. And what was I thinking with that gold font? And the subject! Low-hanging fruit, to be sure, but if you're going to judge the worst musicals ever made, you can't pick a better place to start than an animated, sugar-coated version of the Titanic sinking, complete with rapping dog. Thank Lucifer that other Italian Titanic cartoon didn't have any songs in it, because I've heard— What do you mean the sequel does? How do you even make a sequel to a Titanic movie in the first place? I'm going to have to watch this abortion of all taste and common sense, aren't I? Well, this presents a bit of a problem. I'm not about to sit down and watch the first movie, but how can I evaluate the second without that frame of reference? What am I thinking? This is the information age. I can crowdsource it. Okay, Internet, Legend of the Titanic in under 90 seconds, go!
The plot of Legend of the Titanic, it goeth thusly. Elizabeth is the Kate Winsletty daughter of the Duke of Camden, and she's travelling on the Titanic with her father and her obviously evil stepmother, who wants to marry her off to the even more obviously evil Baron Maltravers.
Grieved by her situation, Elizabeth stands on the bow of the ship and cries into the sea, and the magical moonbeams on the water enable her to talk to animals, as magical moonbeams are wont to do.
Aided by some dolphins and a couple of talking mice, Elizabeth learns that Maltravers is planning on forcing the Duke into signing some papers that would allow him to hunt the whales into extinction. He's also going to sink the ship to cover his tracks by getting a couple of sharks to trick a baby-faced octopus named Tentacles into throwing an iceberg into the ship's path. In other news, I shall now and forever be known as Butterbean, sire of Cuckoo Town! Bye-bye!
The mice also help Elizabeth hook up with a dashing gypsy prince named Don Juan.
Don Juan triumphant!
You just had to go there, didn't you?
Naturally. Continue.
In the end, Tentacles gets guilt-tripped into holding up the Titanic long enough for everybody to get to safety. Maltravers and his accomplices get cast adrift in a rowboat. Elizabeth and Don Juan get married, and everybody lives happily ever after. Even the characters who die to save everybody else. What the—
And with that in mind, let's examine the case of Tentacolino, aka In Search of the Titanic, aka No Seriously, Italy, what is your deal? My Italian's a little fuzzy. That either says 3 years later or that you should be on at least three different drugs before you try to watch this movie. In either case, a bunch of guys lower a bathysphere into the water. Inside it is Elizabeth, Don Juan, and their animal companions, who are searching for the wreckage of the Titanic because none of them got enough of being immersed in the freezing Atlantic the first time around.
It seems to me there are a lot of nasty-looking sharks out there.
No, right! Sharks!
Come here, you two.
Well, it's only normal there are sharks, Smile.
Just because a group of sharks tried to kill us 3 years ago in this exact same place, there's no cause for concern. Right away, the voice acting nets sin number one. Either the delivery is entirely contrary to the situation.
There is something definitely wrong here, and we're in trouble, trust me.
We're likely to die in a watery grave, isn't that peachy? Or the line reading lacks any kind of emotion at all.
We'll destroy him, sink him, put him in a graveyard, push him.
We'll destroy them, we'll sink them, we are evil. Yay. Speaking of the sound, it's incredible how much being deep under the ocean sounds exactly like someone splashing their hands in a Tupperware container full of water. So anyway, the evil shark boss decides to sink Elizabeth and Don Juan's submersible because it's yellow. I'm not even kidding about that.
I can't stand yellow. You know, it's a color of light.
But first he has to get his villain song on, and dear Lord of Darkness, you thought the rapping dog was bad? Meet the rapping shark.
Yo, 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 look at my teeth. They're so sharp and white and neat. They bring on fear and heal some terror. Once they shed, I make no error. With no doubt.
That this is sin number two should come as no surprise. This is the most awkward villain rap I've heard, and remember, I've heard this.
Listen, kid, I think you should know, bad like me is the way to go. Being nice is just for saps. Being good is a handicap.
The verses are clumsy, it shifts into a swing jazz thing in the middle for no particular reason, and the backup singers are incomprehensible. Bottom line, the sharks attack the bathysphere and sink it in order to prove their dominance of the ocean.
The honor is all yours, O treacherous and most majestic leader, undeniable master of all evil!
Dude, I think you've got some serious competition for that title. The nefarious deed done, Shark Boss goes home to pick the cables out of his teeth and to send a telegraph via his Flintstone-style jellyfish wire.
To the Right Honorable Baron Vandertilt.
Wait, what? Now there's another evil Baron in the mix?
I had asked not to be disturbed under any circumstances. This had better be very important.
No, it's the same guy from before. Well, sin number three then, changing the character names. This is clearly an issue with the English dub, since the Italian credits list character names that are consistent with those in Legend of the Titanic. But it's still odd and confusing. Baron Maltravers is now Baron Vandertilt, Tentacles the Octopus is Artie, Ice the Boss Shark is now Razorteeth. Maybe I should just start calling myself Margaret Von Fuzzylegs for the remainder of the case. Anyway, Tentacles, or Artie, or the Dweller in the Depths, or whatever he's calling himself these days, comes upon the sunken craft and finds his old friend slowly asphyxiating inside. But for some reason, the small metal sphere is too much for something that once held up the largest ocean liner of the day, so he needs some backup.
Whoa!
As luck would have it, the Titanic went down just a stone's throw away from the mythic kingdom of Atlantis, and the Atlanteans show up with some helpful breathing helmets in an aerosol can, which helps them take the shipwrecked party to safety.
Keep calm, you're all safe.
No, I'm dead. And you're taking me to Doggy Hell.
Actually, Doggy Hell does involve eternal bath time, so he's not too far off the mark here. Once in Atlantis, the land dwellers are taken to the hospital by a nurse in a cowboy hat, where they will undergo a special treatment.
You must be joking! I'm not undergoing any treatment! No, no, absolutely not!
I'm keeping my family jewels and I don't care what Bob Barker says! But no, cowboy nurse explains that it will enable him to breathe underwater, which puts his mind at ease. Luckily, he can't see into the Atlantis throne room, otherwise his mind might be put right out of ease again.
Oh, amazing! This is such great news! At last, we've got a reason to party!
What are you, and how can I make you go away? There must have been some high-grade weed going around the writer's room. And in Atlantis, there's like this red dolphin and a fish, only he doesn't swim around, he bounces on a spring. And there's like this stone guy with plants all over him and a kind of otter stingray thing. Man, I'm starving. Let's go get some fried polenta. Worst of this collection of oddities is sin number four, Pingo. He's the spring-loaded fish thing, he's creepy, he's loud, and he talks like a terrible Paul Lynde impersonator. He also has a penchant for flamboyant capes and delivers the worst song in the entire movie. And no, I haven't forgotten about the rapping shark.
It's fun and games here in Atlantis. And you never, never get tired of anything. So, here we go again.
The water is fresh, you can swim around. At the fish on deck, it's a real cool sound.
How did they come up with the musical styles in this movie? Did Drew Carey draw them out of a hat? All right, Pingo, you have to sing to Elizabeth and Don Juan in the style of Tin Pan Alley and 80s New Wave. And just when you think it can't get any creepier, this is the payoff.
But one thing I've got to tell you. Up there, you can't go back.
You're stuck here.
Yes, as explained by the King and Queen of Atlantis, who are cosplaying as the Ghost of Christmas Yet to Come and Padme Amidala for some reason, our heroes were given the Elixir of Life when they came to Atlantis, which will allow them to live forever, and because of this, they can never return to their homes. As you can imagine, this is a pretty big...
On the contrary, it's better that we were told about the situation right away. And I have to say your counselor informed us in the most amusing way.
Or not. Sin number five is how casually everyone deals with this plot point. First, the scene where they're given the elixir has some pretty stupid rationalization from Don Juan.
Of course. Keep calm. If they wanted to harm us, they wouldn't have saved us. And this elixir is such a pretty color.
Yeah, so is toilet bowl cleaner. You going to chug a glass of that next? And then there's how accepting the heroes are of their new situation in what must be the fastest onset case of Stockholm Syndrome on record. What about Elizabeth's father? Doesn't one of the mice have a wife back home? What if they don't want to live forever? Isn't anyone just a little bit disturbed by the fact they've been given absolutely no option on their fate? This is the creepiest behavior by a rescue party since Lost Horizon. It should be a major source of conflict, or at least addressed with more than an, eh, no biggie. I guess we're supposed to believe the characters are so taken in by Atlantis they see no problem with staying there, which would be a bit more plausible if so much of the place didn't look like the lobby of a comfort inn. Actually, that's sin number 6, how utterly random the production design is in this movie. When you build a fictional world from the ground up, you're likely going to be drawing on a lot of different sources, but it all has to fit together somehow. For example, the setting in Big Hero 6 is equal parts San Francisco and Japan, but it's combined in a way to create a unified style. The disparate influences complement each other and create a new and believable place. The design in this movie is a hodgepodge of incongruous, random elements that make no sense together. Why are Elizabeth and Don Juan dressed in 1990s business casual? Why do some of the Atlanteans have tails and others don't? And why do some of them ride horses or weird dinosaur things while others tool around in submarines? Why have the palace inhabited by a bunch of living toys like some failed production of The Nutcracker? There's nothing here to inspire the imagination. It's just an unattractive mess. Anyway, it looks like the whole you're stuck in Atlantis forever thing isn't good for any conflict, so what else is going on in this movie? Well, Smile the dog gets sweet on a pretty lady dog and frolics with her while she makes noises that sound like they belong in a much more mature movie. And the mice, Top, Connors, and Ronnie, get accosted by some of the locals.
Hey, you two. If I'm not mistaken, you're the new guys, right?
Ah, so I'm guessing this is the Pie Rat King, then? Your hatred only makes me stronger! Actually, evil pirate rat and unbelievably outdated Asian stereotype rat are just lackeys for the rat leader. You know what? I honestly don't think he's given a name. He aspires to be the Rat Emperor, so I guess that will have to do. Whoever he is, he spends a lot of time ranting about his plans to his followers.
Right. Then we'll be able to go back up to the surface, and thanks to the elixir, we'll be able to conquer the world and rule over everyone! We can leave behind this weird place forever, with its people, fish, and silly toys!
Wait, are we sure these are the antagonists? Because I'm totally on board with this! Okay, the whole rats taking over the Earth thing would have its drawbacks, but I'm all for getting out of Nutsville as soon as possible.
We should get rid of Biagio, that annoying little weasel! And then I'll get a screwdriver, and I'll dismantle that stupid soft toy Pingo myself!
Yes, destroy Pingo, scatter his springs to the currents! Oh, he's saying what we're all thinking! Alas, Connors and Ronnie spill the beans to the rest of the protagonists before that part of the Emperor's platform can be put into action.
No one will hurt you. They'll have to have a screwdriver, and down here in Atlantis, there are no screwdrivers. They've all been banned.
Atlantis? Banned? Screwdrivers. This place is making North Korea look like a model of freedom and sanity. Since the renegade rats need to steal the elixir of life in order to carry out their world domination plans, the king decides to replace it with a fake and sends Ronnie and Connors back undercover with the rebels so that they can be in on the heist. Pingo is put in charge of the switch, no doubt because he's such a subtle and cunning character.
Just this will be all I'll just get if I could accessorize. Here we are, ready, your majesty.
The plan is pulled off in the midst of a tussle that makes the catfight in Manos look like the climax of Kill Bill Volume 1, and the rats make off with a fake elixir. And so the Atlanteans set off in pursuit because... okay, movie, time out. Exactly what the here is the reasoning behind any of this? I'm perfectly willing to believe that whatever MacGuffin you put into the story is essential for the Emperor's plans of conquest, but how exactly does that work? And if it's been replaced with a fake, why does the entire Atlantean army engage the villains in a big battle afterwards? A token chase would have been sufficient to make the ruse convincing. Nothing that happens in the last half hour of the movie makes any sense. Speaking of the battle, that's sin number 8. A good fight sequence is a lot like a good dance. There's a reason why we call it fight choreography. There's rhythm, direction, and an arc to the movement. No matter how many people are involved or how rapid the editing is, you can follow the flow of the action and see how it fits into the story as a whole. This fight scene doesn't have any of that. We can't tell where the characters are in relation to each other or how their actions affect the outcome of events. There's just the Atlanteans shooting lasers at the rats and the sharks and Vandertilt's goons who've been brought in because we're trying to justify his presence in the movie somehow, with no logic or motivation to any of it. It does, however, have two things I can guarantee you won't see in any other animated movie. A transgender Scottish Highlander doll.
What is your name, my child?
I'm called Brumali, Your Majesty, but I'm not a little girl.
Listen to that voice.
And a dog riding a seashell shooting a laser gun at a racially insensitive rodent. In the end, the Atlantean laser blasts somehow give the Baron amnesia, and he forgets the whole battle for the Titanic, or whatever it was that just happened, and the rats escape with the fake elixir. So we should be wrapping up in oh say what? Yes, after the long drawn-out battle, we get a long drawn-out ending. These two sequences make up nearly one-third of the movie, and you feel every infernal minute of it. First, there's the fallout from the whole fake elixir of life issue, in which the Emperor tries to prove the elixir's properties and nearly drowns an old man in the process.
Him.
So all the evil rats are locked in a loony bin in a scene that takes a surprisingly dark turn for this movie.
He's got a really big personality, but unfortunately there's no hope for him. He's as mad as a hatter. He keeps talking about Atlantis, of mermen and mermaids, of conquering the world. I'm afraid we'll have to keep him in here. Forever.
As for the heroes, well, they all have a good laugh at the bad guys winding up in a Dr. Caligari nightmare, and the king has a special present for Elizabeth and Don Juan.
Here is the reward we promised you. This island is now yours, and this will be your new home.
So, they get to spend forever on a deserted island with a fabled shipwreck, which is looking surprisingly good for having spent the past 3 years underwater. That sounds like a rejected story idea for Lost. And so, having raced the Titanic, thus negating the only part of the original movie that was even remotely historically accurate, let the lousy celebratory song and dance commence!
One more night to love you again. One more time to relive my dreams. We will meet again. Just wait and see. Heaven knows that you'll always be.
Making an animated musical out of the Titanic sinking is a terrible idea, but it does have a certain twisted logic to it, born out of the more successful attempts to make kid-friendly versions of dark subject matter. But In Search of the Titanic is just incomprehensible. Watching it gives you no clue of what the creators were thinking or what they were trying to accomplish. The story, the characters, and even the music are a conflicting mess of ideas piled together in the proverbial train wreck you gaze at in horrified fascination. It's incredible. Every time I think I've seen every possible manifestation of film musical atrocity, something comes along that proves me wrong. It worries me to think what fresh here is waiting for me on my case list. Oh, well. Aren't they odd? Aren't they swell? Musicals that wind up here burning in hell.
send in the crap. Songs that don't work. Sequels that rot. Characters you dearly wish would get stabbed or shot. All of it crap. Who makes this crap? Miscast pop stars. Tired old cliches. Cartoons that terrify you in uncountable ways. Pierce Brosnan piercing your ears with his harsh drunken drone. They're all right here. They must atone. I'll judge their sins, punish them in short. It's not much, but it's my job, so open the court. And send in the crap. The musical crap. It's already here. Maybe I'm odd. Maybe I'm snide. But if you're watching, thank you for joining the ride and sharing this crap. There will be more crap. Just wait till next year.